Hi guys, welcome back. This is Matt Chat, episode 253, featuring a review of this game, Divinity Original Sin. Now, as you know, this game was funded through Kickstarter, and it was just released the latter part of June, June 30th. So it's only been on the market now for just a little over a month. Really solid gameplay, a lot of fun, and there's a lot to cover. So without further ado, here is Divinity Original Sin. And here we go, folks, with Divinity Original Sin. Wonderful, wonderful game from Larian Studios. As you can see there, this is the Kickstarter edition. I interviewed Sven Vinka, the main guy responsible for this game, back in April of 2013. And it seems like I recall, at that time, they weren't even sure they were going to make their $400,000 goal, pledge goal. By the end of it, though, they had over 900,000, just a little shy of a million, 20,000, almost 20,000 backers. I think they might have gotten a little more after the Kickstarter was done, so... They did a really fantastic job on this. Definitely worth the money. The edition I purchased actually had a cloth map and a poster and a little art book, all kinds of fun little things, soundtrack on an actual CD. So I was really impressed with the... I'm going to be focusing on the game here, of course, but I'm also impressed with their packaging and their add-ons. Okay, so what we're dealing with here is kind of a turn-based game. Similar, it's got that same isometric view as games like Baldur's Gate and Icewind Dale. You can do a little bit more with it, as we'll see. You can spin the camera around a little bit. And you get to create two characters and then recruit two more NPCs. Certainly nothing wrong with just going with a default party if it's your first playthrough. But you can also get in here and tweak it. You can decide what classes you want. You can customize the looks of the characters. Get in there and choose different abilities, feats, stats, I mean, whatever you want to do. Our learning curve is not huge with this game, but it probably would behoove you to spend at least a few minutes with the manual, maybe watch a tutorial video or something like that, just to have some idea of the way you want to play. A lot of the common assumptions you might make can be wrong with this game. For example, most role-playing games, you need to have a mage, cleric, fighter, rogue, maybe a couple extra characters, sort of hybrid characters. With this game, though, the rogues are practically useless, I found. Some people like them and swear by them, but I swear at them. You probably want a hunter-type class, ranger, instead of the rogue. And the wizards, there's so many different skills that involve magic. Earth magic, water magic, air magic, witchcraft. What is that, four or five? Anyway, it doesn't hurt to have at least one pure wizard, and then maybe some type of hybrid, so you can pick up all the different schools of magic. See there, you can tweak the look of the characters quite a bit. It's a lot of fun. You can change the gender if you want, but I would, unless you want to play as a gay couple or lesbian couple, you probably want to keep these guys separate genders. Nothing wrong with that if you want to have a same-sex party. There is a bit of a romantic connection, as we'll see.
The sorcerers of Rivalon cured the sick and healed the wounded through a great power called Source. But a terrible darkness invaded the land, and Source was forever tainted. The sorcerers who once healed now only destroy, and madness has overtaken them. A few brave Source hunters are all that stand between Rivalon and the dark power that threatens to destroy it. Wherever Source appears, hunters follow.
Any similarities to the Wheel of Time saga are purely coincidental. Alright, here's the little opening cutscene. Any game that starts off with on a ship can't be all bad, right? I was trying to think of all the different role-playing games I've played that start off like this.
Master Source Hunters. The captain wants you up on deck. Them calls means we're close to shore. Don't ever you go in there, Master Source Hunters. City's full of undead, hungry and out for blood. But you're supposed to investigate that murder, ain't you? They say it's Source that did the counselor in. Source in a city like Sicile, nowhere safe anymore. Here they are, Captain, sir.
God's blessings on you, Hunters. You'll be happy to hear we've reached Sicile. But there's trouble offshore, so we'll have to sail in carefully. Here, have a look.
Those are orc ships, and they're blocking our passage. We'll get you as close to the city as we can, and drop you off on the beach. Be wary now. Orcs are on the attack. Undead have closed every route out, and there's a sorcerer on the loose. If we're to get justice for the Counselor, you'll have to keep your wits about you. May the luck of the gods be with you both, sorcerer.
As you can see, these aren't mind-blowing cutscenes by any means, but I actually consider that to be a positive thing about the game, believe it or not, because it shows that they didn't blow money on stupid frills. I mean, this gets the job done, right? I mean, the animation's fine. So what if they didn't hire Industrial Light and Magic to do their cutscene? That's a decent job setting up the story. The voice work is fine. The artwork looks good, so I'm actually rather pleased that they didn't waste their money on that kind of crap and focused instead on the gameplay part of it, which was really where the game shines. As you can see, these initial loading sequences can be rather lengthy. Now, fortunately, that only happens when you first start up the game. And after that, they either don't see them at all or they're really quick. At any rate, they give you some nice, lovely music to listen to, a nice piece of artwork, questionably useful suggestions. Alright, so there's our characters. Some interesting things you can do in this game. It's easy to split up your party into different teams, I guess. That can move independently. You can even have two inventory screens open and your bags open. So it makes it a little bit easier to manage your inventory. Now apparently these trunks, I think some of the stuff might be Kickstarter bonus items. Like, if you put on these trunks, you'll hear a voice come on every now and then. Some humorous lines. I'll go ahead and put those on. You also notice I have a golden grail. That is really cool there. Now you can use that to, I guess, put a little sparkle on armor that you find and increase the value. It doesn't do anything, as far as I know, but make it a little bit more valuable to barter with. You also notice you can keep that pouch or bag satchel thing open separately than the inventory. That can be useful if you want to stick all your materials for crafting in just one bag, and then you can just give it to somebody. Picking up all these skulls and shells.
If I didn't know there were orc ships raiding to the west, I'd mistake this for a placid beach.
At least the orcs make a bit of noise when they attack. It's dark-dealing sorcerers that'll strike with neither warning nor mercy.
Poor old sorcerers getting a bad rep here. Now you can pick up all these shells. They do give you a little bit of a water resistance bonus. In a lot of games, you're like fire. Oh, look, that ring has fire resistance or earth resistance. So what? Big deal. In this game, it actually is a pretty big deal. A lot of these mobs, I mean, some of these battles can be so tough. But they're not that tough if you pay attention to, for example, are they using fire
spells?
Is that
a corpse? What's it doing here alone?
What, did you expect it to have an entourage?
And if they are using fire on you, you can, buff up your fire resistance. And, suddenly an impossible battle, quote-unquote, is something quite easy. So definitely behooves you to keep an eye on that. Now the scrolls in the inventory, you might be tempted to use those right away. Or you might be more like me. You guys will have to let me know if you're the same way. But I always like to hoard my scrolls and potions. I hate to have to use those things for some reason, even though they give you like thousands. This game, though, you do end up having to use that stuff just to stay alive. Now, the cool thing about scrolls, though, I was going to tell you is you might not want to use those. You might want to at least keep one of each type of scroll handy and not use it. Because later on, you'll be able to put those into a book and learn them as spells. And as far as I can tell, that's the only way to get some spells, so it's something to think about. Also, this is kind of cool too. So when you are in conversation, sometimes your characters will have a little role play, a little rock paper scissors kind of thing going, and you can gain points in these different traits, and they have different perks. Like some will boost your crafting score, or some will make you lucky. Now this lucky charm, to me, that's well worth the points, believe it or not. What you want to do is have one character buff up their luck, and then every time you open up a chest or look in a barrel or a bookshelf or whatever, always use that character who's lucky. And man, you'll find a lot of bonus gear that way. I mean, it got to the point where it's like every character was weighed down with rare and valuable items. So I had no problem with money. So don't think that lucky charm thing is a waste. Definitely worth beefing that up. Another thing I'll just say right off the bat, you notice how I'm going through water? Man, this game will punish you severely if you don't pay attention to that, what your characters are standing in. Plus there's that shell, the guy down there, trying to get to him, but I think I'll have to have a little battle first.
Curses upon them, source hunters! Secure the stone! I'll deal with these rats.
Goddess, be with you, master!
He said rats!
Let me show you what these rats can do.
Arise! Arise! Drawn forth from blood, I bid you aid.
I actually love it when they give you all these stealthy options and then it's all rendered moot. You know, most battles, or at least a lot of the battles, it just something like this happens and they just instantly summon a whole bunch of mobs. You're sort of caught in the middle of it. Man, they are so deceptive in these first couple battles. I mean, it is so easy. You just about have to, unless you fall on your sword, you're probably going to beat these guys, no problem. But don't expect that to last. Oh, hell no. this game is going to, you're going to be screaming at your monitor. Most of these battles, well, even the ones that are relatively easy, a lot can change in just one turn. Couple bad rolls, you can be screwed. So enjoy the easy battles while they last. As you can see, I've got all kinds of different abilities and they all have different cooldown timers. Usually it's a good idea to just go ahead and use them. Your default attacks are usually not nearly as powerful as your abilities, and the cooldowns are pretty quick. You know, she's already got a summon spell right off the bat. That's pretty cool. The summon monsters, you can control them completely, which is basically just like temporary party members. So you're going to be using those a lot. Now each character can only control one summon creature, but you could, if you have summon spells on all your characters, you could have an additional four, you know, party members. So I think it's worthwhile to give everybody at least enough magic to be able to summon something. You know, if nothing else, the summon monsters can be cannon fodder. Especially if you're going up against, say, fire elementals and you summon a fire elemental. Every time they attack that fire elemental, they'll actually be healing him. So it'll be basically indestructible. And you won't have to worry about your other characters taking damage if you can position them right. So, short of it is, summoning stuff is really cool. Yeah, see, these default attacks, not really all that impressive. And the spiders. Of course, they've got this poison ability.
Their leader said
not
something about escaping with a stone.
Stolen from this dungeon, I imagine. Can we get inside?
Ah, yes. A fantasy game involving magical crystal. Stones! Stones, not crystals. Now, you'll be collecting blood stones, star stones, kidney stones. I mean, there's all kinds of stones. joking aside, I mean, it's pretty well. Structure of the storyline. All of this is related. The stones, the source, your two characters here, their backstories. There's a lot about themselves that they don't know. It's really cool. As you play, you'll learn more about where they come from. And it's just kind of revealed piece by piece, and it all comes together quite nicely towards the end. So, rather happy with the story. I think I'm closing in on this oyster guy.
Dry air,
oh, there he is. Let's go see what's up with him. Call me Ishmael. Ah, yes. Some of you literature nerds probably know where that comes from. A little book called Moby Dick. That's one of the things I love about this game. It never takes itself that seriously. I mean, it's a lot of puns and gags, and some of it's just, you know, laugh out loud silly. It doesn't get so over the top where, you know, it's just a lampoon of itself or anything like that, but it definitely got quite a few chuckles out of me. There's also lots of little surprises like this guy, the shell. I mean, you can stick to the main quest, but sometimes you just want to just explore around because you never know what you're going to find. There's lots of little side quests and things that, you know, I guess you could look at some kind of online guide and find them all, but I would say, you know, especially if it's your first time playing through, try not to use those. It's about half the fun is just discovering stuff on your own. Now, I haven't tried to play this multiplayer. I guess this is why they set it up this way. But sometimes your two characters will get into a disagreement, and they'll use a little rock, paper, scissors game. So this is, you know, the higher your charisma score, the more points you'll get if you win one of these matches. And as far as I can tell, this isn't completely random. I mean, I could be just completely delusional here. But it seems like the computer follows some kind of basic strategy. Like if he wins, if you win with the rock, then he'll try to use paper next time. You can try to anticipate his moves a little bit. But it doesn't always work. And I guess there is a certain randomness to it. I ended up losing about 50-50 with those. Especially if the whoever you're arguing with has a higher charisma score, you're probably, unless you're really lucky, gonna lose. It's kind of cool later in the game, though. You can, if you win one of those arguments, you get some experience points for that, and then you can kill them anyway afterward and get even more experience points. So usually when I played this the other times, I threw him back in the water and got a chest. Now this time he looks like he's actually in my inventory. Talking shell you picked up from the beach. I don't know, what happens if I try to use it? Apparently nothing. Okay, that probably wasn't the smartest move, but oh well. Let's move on.
This is a single malt imported all the way from Hawkesbury, you know. They ain't the local pigswell they sell for ale.
Single malt, my stubbly ass. You've been had by one of them.
It's really fun, the little dialogue you can overhear. Although, man, they can get repetitive. These guys basically just say the same things over and over. And they can get really annoying if you're trying to do some crafting or something. It just keeps playing over and over. You probably should have put some of that stuff on a timer. Alright, so there's a pretty involved crafting system. It's, to be frank, it's not all that great. But you can find items and just combine them in your inventory to make things. Unfortunately, the only way you can learn about these recipes is either online, just by trial and error, or by finding these recipe books, but it's just not as, it's not done as well as it could have been. I'm making a little pizza here. I usually found that my inventory would just get full of mats, and I wasn't really able to make the food. Just wasn't really all that useful, especially once you get healing spells. And I guess maybe I could have, maybe the food is useful and I just didn't really learn how to use it that well. I mean, it can heal you, give you a few little buffs and things. I don't really think it's essential. It didn't seem to be. You know, make potions with mushrooms. Probably the best use for crafting I found was later in the game when you can make those spell books, or skill books, out of scrolls. It's kind of indispensable. I guess you can make some money by making items and selling them, but as I said before, money wasn't really an issue for me. Alright, so here's the battle. Now, I've skipped the tutorial dungeon
Charge!
This time.
Kill the unbelievers!
So basically, these guys have a level on me, and you're going to see me get my butt whipped. Thought I would show you how hard it can get really quick in this game. Now, I guess the smart thing to do here would be actually to run away. Now, there are some other warriors here that are on my side. They're guys in green. So there's nothing wrong with that, trying to get back out of range. Maybe let those guys wheel them down a little bit. But what the heck, we'll just go in here and see what we can do. Throw some spider in the mix. Now what really tends to happen if you're too low level, you're going to miss a lot. Your spells are going to get resisted a lot. And then anything they throw at you, conversely, is going to hit. And you know, if nothing else, maybe even do bonus damage. So it can get really difficult really quick. One of the things that they love to do to your character is stun them. So many ways to get basically paralyzed. You can be petrified, stunned, knocked down, blinded. All kinds of really nasty debuffs they can give you. And if you're basically just standing there for three whole turns, well, they're free to whack you. You're not going to last too long. And that tends to happen 10 times more often if you're lower level than they are. So these other guys are coming in to join the fray. Notice how when they hit somebody, the blood forms a little puddle underneath them. You have to watch that, because that counts as, you know, basically standing in water. So if anybody tries to electrify that area, everybody standing in the blood is going to get electrocuted. Three turns. You can't do anything for three turns but stand there and take damage. That can get infuriating quick. Now she's got a bleed ability, so that's a little damage over time effect. As you can see, you know, I'm just barely scratching these guys. It's not doing nearly enough damage. I mean, they're doing way more to me than I am to them, so probably just a matter of time before my guys are dead. Oh man, and the archers. Whoever did this game, man, they love their archers. There's all kinds of special arrows you can get that are just insane. Basically, any spell you can cast is an arrow equivalent. And once you get enough, you know, speed and action points going, you can lob two of those per turn. And that'll quickly become one of your main damage dealers. But it really sucks if you're up against three or four archers and they're spread out. You might be dead before you can get to them. Very serious. Let's see, I've got a little buff I can put on somebody. I'm going to go ahead and put it on one of these legionnaires instead of my guys. Basically, this makes them do 50% more damage. So it makes sense to put that on whoever's doing the most damage. And I have a little left over. There goes that archer. Nasty business. I want to know who would prefer to have a rogue instead of an archer in this game, because you'd be missing out on all those cool arrows. And he's dead. Well, you can resurrect characters. Later on, you can just use a spell to do it. It's not that big of a deal. If you lose both your main characters, though, it's game over. I'm just going to go ahead and reload here and show you some of the later game. So here's the characters I was actually able to complete the game with. I got a fighter slash pyro, and a fighter slash hydro cleric type thing. Then I've got my archer, and then the wizard. Now this wizard at the bottom, Shahan is his name, maybe something like that. But he's the character you can actually meet and recruit, and he's got some plot elements that go along with him. I was only able to find one other character like that, and I didn't really need her. She was another fighter. But I don't really know how many other characters are out there. Maybe that's something for future playthroughs. I might do a little research to see. As you can see, these characters have plenty of interesting abilities. She's got all the special arrows she can use. Now the cool thing about charging, well, one, it'll get you across the battlefield quick. Two, it can affect multiple enemies. And three, it has a good chance of knocking them down, tripping them, basically immobilizing them for at least one turn, if not three. So. That's really cool. If the characters are knocked down or blinded or something like that, you get 100% accuracy. And then there's some further ways to take advantage of that.
To me!
The archer is just too far back. She'll probably miss. You want to get her a little closer?
Yes! Another one bites the puddle it fell in.
Yeah, this little guy here. This is a little quest. I messed it up the first few times I did it. He just takes off and you have to follow him. And he'll get into a couple of little encounters along the way, but if you can get him all the way back to town, you get some pretty nice rewards for that. He just stands there, doesn't really help you. These are skeletons. Another thing about the bone creatures, the skeletons, they don't take as much damage. They absorb a lot of the damage if you're using sharp weapons, swords, and arrows and things. I think you get a bonus if you use a mace or a hammer, you know, something like that. I just, you know, it's not that hard. You do have to pay attention. Some of the creatures, you'll actually heal them by attacking if you use the wrong element. So So, you know, if it's a fire elemental and you hit him with a fireball, well, you've just healed him. And some of the really cool things you can do with your weapons is put, you know, bonus damage, like bonus earth damage or poison damage or something like that. So you really have to put some thought into it, because you might actually be healing the enemies every time you swing it. There we go. Some of the talents you might want to think about too. I've got talents on these guys that give them an attack of opportunity. Which actually, what that means is if they try to run away, you can get a free attack. And that, I don't know if they what the deal is with that, but it turned out to be really, really useful. I mean, that thing procced routinely, once or twice a battle, and sometimes it really made all the difference. So I would definitely consider getting that. And there's another one that gives you bonus damage if the, I think it's called Bully. So if the character, the mob is knocked down or paralyzed or something like that, you do bonus damage. And that's another one that ended up being a lot more useful than I thought. I'm up here against a bunch of spiders. Just thought I'd show you what some of the bigger battles can look like. Now it is turn-based, and unfortunately some of these creatures take quite a long time to go through their little animations. You know, these guys burrow under the ground, pop back up and attack, throw poison at you, and it can take quite a while, especially when there's this many of them. It really would have been nice. One of my major complaints about this game is that there's no way to speed up the combat animations or just skip them entirely. So, yeah, I mean, some of these battles, you're getting up, going to get a drink or something, come back, and the computer's still taking its turn. Fortunately, that's not often the case. Looking at all my options here. Now, you do have to be careful if there's a monster blocking the other ones. You won't be able to shoot the arrow over its head, so pretty easy to blow yourself up that way. So that little attack there, you can see it did quite a lot of damage. It hit all those different spiders and it hit each one for about 100 points of damage. So, you know, that alone's worth the price of having the archer along. It's just one of her special attacks too. It wasn't even a special arrow. Trying a little crowd control there, just froze that one. That'll take care of him for at least 3 rounds. And this wizard here, I've got this ability as the water resistance shield. Now, even though they call it water resistance shield, it's much better than that. It doesn't just protect you against water. It actually protects you against all damage. But you get some bonus effects. I think that one, if they hit you, there's a chance they might freeze. But you're more vulnerable to... I think you're more vulnerable to fire or water. Anyway, usually the shields have something that you're vulnerable to. Yeah, see, so since I used that fire-based attack, it ignited that poison cloud. Did some bonus damage. Now these spiders are back. See how they're burrowing. I guess they don't have enough action points left when they pop back up to actually attack. Well, that one did. So throwing poison at me. Poison, poison, poison. What is it with these role-playing games and their poison, man? At least the poison in this game, it only lasts for 3 turns. Remember some of those games, characters would just take poison to the die and ran all the way back to the temple. Thinking of you might match 6. Not that bad here. Yep, see there's that attack of opportunity right there. 146 points of damage. Yeah, the AI is not exactly shining at the moment, is it? That thing burrowed right up on top of a fire pit. Killed himself. And she's pretty low on health, so I'm going to go ahead and waste one of her turns healing. And that was a problem I had with my rogue, was the guy would just, for some, whatever reason, it seemed like every monster always attacked him. So he would, I'd have to just waste all my other characters' turns healing and bandaging him just to keep him alive instead of attacking. Got rid of him. Got the archer, and she's got... I mean, she didn't have that problem. They just didn't like the cut of my jib or what. It's like I had like this bullseye on his head. Okay, let's see what this guy can do. Let's try to do this head vice. This has a chance to blind. Unfortunately, it doesn't always work. I'm not... You know, it's supposed to show you what the creatures are resistant to and vulnerable to. I don't know why that doesn't work for me. I guess my lore master spell's not high enough. Never could get that part to work. But I guess you could look it up online and figure out what I'm pretty sure every creature has some kind of vulnerability. One thing you probably notice is that there are no hexes on the ground showing me how many action points it would take to move somewhere. Instead, it uses just a, to my mind, very intuitive ruler system, kind of like the old war games with it. Maybe you take out the string. But I guess this probably takes into consideration the level of the terrain and so on, the type of terrain it is, you know, and how far you can move per action point. And I think it also depends on your character's speed, you know, how many action points it takes to move somewhere. So it's fairly involved. I mean, there's a lot of tactics and strategy going on in this game that I really like. And of course, it's not for everybody. You know, some people won't like these long, drawn-out battles. If you're the type of person that's playing World of Warcraft and yelling, go, 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 go at the tank, yeah, you're probably not going to like this. Don't even buy it. Let's go back to WoW. You might have noticed that wind or whatever it is there is actually causing my characters to have a slow effect, which eats into those action points. And that's actually a pretty big deal. First few times I played this, I didn't really pay much attention to the action point part of it, you know, other than just, you know, immediate combat. But there's three different stats, speed, perception, and constitution, that all have some effect on action points. And it's really worth it to look into that. Make sure you've, you know, sometimes it's better to go ahead and put more points in, say, speed or constitution than it is to add another point of strength or intelligence, even though that's your main stat. Because if you get enough action points, you can actually get two attacks per turn instead of just one. You know, my archer had so many at one point, I was able to, every start of each battle, is able to summon a monster and charm another monster before that anybody else even got to move. So that was pretty awesome. And I guess the action points are a big part of the game mechanic of this, so you know, definitely pay some thought to that. Alright, so I'm not able to cast this. I'm trying to find a place to cast my Skeletal Warrior, but unfortunately you have to be able to see to do that. I think my character is blinded, or looks like she's smoking, actually. Smoking hot. Not in a good way. In a I can't see where to cast my Skeleton Warrior kind of way. So that kind of stinks. Looks like my wizard has the same problem. Man, I wish I could get these guys some kind of infrared goggles. Yeah, blinding. Being blind is not cool at all. I don't know what would be scarier, being surrounded by giant spiders, being surrounded by giant spiders you couldn't see, or being surrounded by giant spiders who are on fire and you can also not see. I think we know the answer to that. It looks like I could still hit him with a lightning bolt, so let's try that out. I usually don't use this one because it seems like it inevitably stuns my guys instead of the monsters, but looks like it at least did some damage that time. This guy gets a nice radius on his little whirlwind or dust devil attack. It's always cool. Critical strikes are always cool. Looks like I'm going to survive this battle after all. But you know, again, this is just a regular routine battle in Divinity Original Sin. Nothing special here. But it gives you a pretty good idea, I think, of the level of involvement of these battles. I mean, if you're like me and you're into tactical combat, this will be your bread and butter. Now, I have to show you guys this. I mean, it's a pretty good example of the type of puzzles they have in the game. It's not just straight up, you know, role-playing, you know, combat after combat. There's actually quite a few adventure game elements. This is one. I've heard about a rat king. Kind of got my attention, as you would expect. And I found these rat holes, and I'm sort of guessing that I need to put some cheese out in front of the hole to lure the rat out. And I've done that. Got some experience points, but as you can see, they just came out and ate the cheese and went back in the hole. So I'm guessing I have to do a little bit more than just put cheese out there. I'm guessing I need to poison the cheese. Let me try that. Now, I think I might have mentioned this, but if you find empty potion bottles, you can put mushrooms in them and you'll make poisons and different kinds of healing potions and buff potions. I mean, there's a whole, you know, whole huge list of things you can make. But I made this poison cheese, and then I get to meet the Rat King! Rathew. I wonder. What do you think? Rathew? Matthew? Matt? Likes rats? Ah, it's coincidence. Look at that little crown on him. Oh, look at that. So you can side with the Rat King, or you can side with the cat people. And unfortunately, the rats are evil. But I couldn't help myself. I had to side with him the first time anyway. But I'll leave it for you. You can play this yourself and see what happens.
You dare to challenge your commander, Wormbelly?
He's no commander of ours, orc scum.
It seems that tribesman walked right into one of the wizard's traps.
Let's prove wiser than him, shall we?
Yeah, I don't think we're going to prove wiser than him. I wanted to show you this, too, because early in the game you get these little pyramids. This little teleporters, basically. If you leave one somewhere, you can come back and teleport to it. And any place you can see through, you can toss one of those pyramids through and then teleport there. So I'd forgotten about these. You know, first time I played and I got stuck and had to look it up. Like, oh yeah, don't forget about those pyramids. They can come in handy situation like this and go right through that door. Bada bing. So don't forget about your little pyramid teleporter things. They come in handy in quite a few situations in the game. Also, anything gold plated will fetch a pretty good price at the one of the shops. So go ahead and pick up all the plates and silverware. This is kind of fiendish here. So he's got this ledge up here in this little book called Psi Powers. And what you think is, character has telekinesis, so you can pick up something that's, you know, up on a shelf, but it seems it doesn't matter how high your telekinetic score is, you can never get that book. So it's just a little evil little tease. You know, hopefully nobody playing this spent that long trying to figure that out. You know, another thing they love about this game is hiding these little buttons everywhere. So there's a little area that really stumped me hard. So you guys that are concerned about spoilers probably want to skip the next couple minutes here. But basically, you're in this room, you know you got to get inside that center part of the room somehow. There's these little switches you can find, and you really have to be looking hard to see them. But the secret is in this book. I'm not going to spell this out for you, but... You know, if you read between the lines here, you'll see the order that you're supposed to press these switches in. Now, see, I spent the better part of an hour. I thought I'd missed a switch somewhere in this room. I just went around and around and around forever trying to find them all. Apparently, this little rat will help you find the switches. It really helped me that much.
Why, hello there. Why, then.
You can get an ability, by the way, to talk to rats. I foolishly did not get it on these characters. Yeah, I know, foolish. Passing up the chance to talk to rats! It's kind of insane! Alright, but it's not just the order in the book, though. If you look on the floor, you might notice another clue. Again, I don't want to spoil it for you, but if you look at the direction of that compass there, you might notice something kind of peculiar. And you also have to take that into consideration to solve the puzzle, so
I wonder
it's
what
pretty
that
evil.
Did.
Here's something else. I could never get past this battle. Once you finally figure out how to get inside that room... Oh man, the battle that follows is hard. I mean, it was just about impossible with these guys. They're kind of underpowered. But even when I came back later with a better party, better equipped party, it still was a big challenge, but... I did discover a little trick. I thought I would pass this on to anybody else that wants it. Do you notice I've got all these chairs, and I guess this would work for any situation where you've got furniture, stuff you can move, but if you line it up tight enough, the monsters won't be able to make a path through it, so they'll just get stuck on the other side. They can still hit you with ranged attacks, but you know, if you do it tight enough, and the way you can tell is if you just you keep clicking on both sides, and if your characters have to go around, the monsters will also have to go around. You can actually block both sides of this, and if you do it just right, you can only have to fight one mob at a time. You know, once you dispatch the main guy, you can use your teleportation spells to bring the other guys in one at a time and take them out that way. That was the only way I was able to get past this battle with this particular party. Later on, I was able to do a little bit better than this, or at least a little bit less hinky of a strategy. But I had a party that, you know, everybody had something they could summon. Everybody had shields. So it went a little bit easier. But I just thought I'd pass this on to anybody that's really just having a hard time. There's something else. that this game will occasionally do to you. You're up against invulnerable monsters. And, you know, if you're like me, you keep thinking, well, there must be some way to fight them anyway. They must be vulnerable to something. But, no, actually, they're just invulnerable. And the only thing you can do is run from these guys. And, man, there's a couple different situations like this in the game where you just have to run from monsters and get to a teleporter or something along those lines. And I don't know, I'm not used to thinking I need to run away. I just would get hopelessly stuck at these parts and then have to just go to some other area. So there's just a few little spots. I'll just pass this on too if you're playing this. If you get into an area where you're up against invulnerable monsters, it may be that you're just supposed to run away from them. Nice little trick, though. If you remember that you could split up your party into different teams, one of your characters has invisibility, so you just keep using that and just stealth all the way through the area and not get attacked. It comes in quite handy on a couple situations. Now, some parts of the game are obviously inspired by the Witcher series.
My friend returns.
Because you're the answer to all my prayers.
Until we meet again.
You'll probably be hearing about this at some point or another. I know Europeans have a different sense of what's proper, I guess, in a game. But basically, you can hire this prostitute and follow her into the bedroom, boudoir, whatever you want to call it. What happens after that? It's just kind of scarred me for life. They've crossed a threshold that shouldn't have been crossed. I'm particularly concerned about all the virgins that probably will play this. And, you know, there's just some things you can't unsee. And
my friend returns.
This is one of them. Anyway, there you have it, folks. Divinity Original Sin. Great game. Definitely one of the favorite game. My favorite games from the past, five years or so. I don't know if I put it on the same level as Baldur's Gate and Icewind Dale and games like that, but it's damn near close. It's definitely as close to that level of fun as I've had, since those games. Way more fun than the Dragon Age games and Diablo 3, stuff like that. It's definitely got a few problems, things that could have been done better. And I'm not really that impressed with the crafting system. I wish there was a way to speed up the combat animations. I'm sort of hesitant to say I don't like the difficulty pacing, because it's actually not hard as long as you make sure you're in the right area. But unfortunately, it's not always clear what you need to do sometimes to get to the right area. There might be a little switch hidden somewhere or something like that. You just have to hook that up. But overall, I really, really enjoyed this game. I think you will too. If you do want to buy it for yourself, I would ask that you get it from GOG, goodoldgames.com. It's also on Steam, but if you get it from GOG, for one thing, you don't have to deal with any copy protection. Two, though, the part of the money will actually help support MatChat, as long as you use the affiliate link on the show notes. It won't cost you anything extra, but it'll help me out, help the show out. So, please consider that. As of this video, it's $40. And I think it's well worth the $40 myself. I haven't even gotten into the co-op mode. That's probably a lot of fun, the multiplayer modes. Also notice there's already quite a few mods. Looking at a site called nexusmods.com, and it looks like they've got mods out for the graphics. There's some kind of foreplay. I guess it lets you have four source hunters. Get kind of excited there for a minute, didn't you? You can play with four source hunters, companion female hairstyles. Okay. Looks like they got crafting tweaks. So that's kind of an exciting space. I'm curious what all they'll come up with. This is the kind of game that would lend itself quite well to fairly extensive modding, maybe some user-generated levels and story arcs and things of that sort. Be really cool. Really, you got everything in here to recreate something like Baldur's Gate. Probably be highly illegal, but man, wouldn't that be cool to have a new Baldur's Gate with this kind of turn-based combat? But anyway, I'll leave you to those pleasant thoughts. If you got other views or things you agree, disagree about, or whatever it is, please let me know. Love to see your comments over on YouTube. Thanks for watching.
And that's all for this week's episode. Hope you guys enjoyed that. Should be back next week with the first part of a new interview series with Mr. Fergus Urquhart. A lot of great stuff in there, including some revelations about his ongoing Kickstarter-related projects. So stay tuned for that. As always, I want to thank you guys very much if you have supported me and the Matt Chat Show. Remember, if you guys would like to support the show, you can just go to the Patreon site in the show notes. It only takes a couple of seconds, really, at most a couple minutes to set that up. And you can support the show any amount you want. $1 per episode, $5 an episode, whatever it is you can afford, you feel comfortable with. I really appreciate it. Also, don't forget, if you haven't bought Divinity Original Sin yet, first of all, what the heck are you waiting for? Second, though, don't just buy it from Steam. Go to GOG.com and look for the, look for the show notes, the link to GOG there. And if you use that affiliate link, then I'll get a small percentage. Won't cost you anything extra, but there'll be a little kickback here to the Matt Chat Show, so you can support the show that way. Plus, I think you really enjoy the game. As a matter of fact, as long as I got you here, I thought I would show you what you get with the, if you buy the, I guess it's a little late now. I don't know if you guys just still get this or what, but here's what I received of the Kickstarter Backer Edition. A really nice box, color printing on both sides, a sturdy construction. As you can see, it's got, of course, the DVD case. This is the soundtrack. I haven't got to listen to this yet, but it looks like there's 22 songs on it. And one thing I did like about Divinity Original Sin was the music. I guess it was composed here by Kirill Pokrovsky. Sounds Polish. Anyway, he did a really good job with the soundtrack, so I'm looking forward to the music on there. Also, the manual, actually a printed manual, really cool. Of course, the cloth map, and they even included put that in a Ziploc bag for you. Take a look inside. Take a look at that. So there you go. You also have two different kinds of cards. This is the first one, I think, is just a regular deck of just straight up playing cards. I haven't opened these yet, but maybe I should. but you know, if you want to just play poker, I guess. Five card stud or what have you. And then this other deck looks like it's some kind of Magic the Gathering style game. You know, I haven't had a chance to really play this, but it's kind of cool. You know, nice little add-ons. Actually give you, it's kind of interesting to, I wonder if anybody's played this. I'd be interested in your comments on it. Then I also received this picture book. I mean, it's really amazing what they were able to get inside that box. You know, this is just basically art, concept art from the game. Really neat. You know, beautiful scenery in there. And of course also the axe here. So I was really happy with all the stuff that came in the box. You know, hopefully you guys supported it on Kickstarter. If not, don't worry, you can still get your copy from GOG, but you might miss out on stuff like this cool cloth map here. So anyway, that's what I got in the Kickstarter box. What about news from the Matt Cave? One cool thing is a really cool thing, actually. As you recall in my review of the Grimrock game, Legend of Grimrock 1, the game had a fatal flaw, namely, no rats in it. No rats were harmed in the production of or playthrough thereof Legend of Grimrock. Thankfully, they have rectified this error. In Legend of Grimrock 2, there's actually a playable race. You know, I don't know any other role-playing game that actually lets you play as a rat. So this will be a first, at least to my knowledge. I'm really excited about this. They're called the Ratlings. And as far as I know, you can actually have a whole party made up of these Ratlings. Kind of a Splinter from Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles-like look to them. So that's really exciting. And I actually made some comments on their Facebook page, Facebook announcement, and they seemed to actually watched my earlier review. So it's good to know Matt Chat is actually having an influence on the industry. Also, not quite sure what to make of this news item, but a company called The Odd Gentlemen are making a new King's Quest game. And this is part of a new effort, I guess. Activision, I believe, is trying to resurrect Sierra. Sierra Online, of course, made King's Quest. Quest for Glory, all those great point-and-click adventure games of the 80s and 90s. Well, Apparently the Odd Gentlemen are trying to resurrect the King's Quest. And they're only, I guess they're best known for a game called The Misadventures of P.B. Winterbottom, which I was looking at that. I haven't played it, but it looks like kind of a cross between Braid and Limbo, kind of a platform adventure game sort of thing. So not sure, I have no idea what they're going to do with the King's Quest franchise, if they're going to try to turn it into something kind of a platform related. Hopefully not, but I did send them a note on their webpage asking for an interview, so maybe they'll get in touch with us. All right, so what about that ale of the week? Well, this week I've got a three-way pale ale, and you got to be very careful how you order one of these. You don't want to just walk up to a bartender and ask for a three-way. Let's see, three-way. It's brewed right up the road, actually, Cold Spring Brewery. Cold Spring, well, the brewery in Cold Springs, Minnesota, which I think is only about 20 minutes away. You know, I really should get up there at some point and visit the place. Let's see, our obsession with the number three is getting so out of control that we've named our beer three-way. Too much? Didn't think so. The sessionable pale ale. What the hell does sessionable mean? It's unlike many others, not only because of its three distinct hops and three select malts, but this brew is a conversation starter, a proposition, and punchline all rolled into one. And hey, if it works, you're welcome. Anyway, let's get this can open and see what it's all about. You know, sometimes just the smelling of beer is almost as fun as drinking it. But anyway, I got some of this three-way here in the rather excellent drinking horn. And smelling it, trying to decide if I, you know, what I think about this obsession with the number three. And I'm wondering if you have a number you're obsessed with, a special number, as it were. I think mine's probably 69, but anyway, so this smells rather hoppy. Kind of a sweet smell to it, sort of a cherry-like, a wheaty smell. It has sort of a cherry wheat-like aroma to it. Anyway, smells really nice. Definitely no skunkiness or anything unpleasant with the aroma. But anyway, let's give it a taste. A little bit of a... What is that? You definitely taste some of the hops in there. I'm unfortunately getting a little bit of the can taste, sort of the metallic flavor from the can. Probably not as intended, but let's give it another taste. Yeah, there's not a whole lot of flavor going on here. You definitely taste a little bit of hops, a little bit of it's a little bit of bitterness, maybe a little bit of a wheaty-like flavor to it. Nothing really stands out, though. I'll try one more time. One thing I'll say for it, at least it's not thin. I mean, it's a nice, creamy, relatively thick texture to it, which is kind of nice. I don't know if I mentioned it's got a 5.2% alcohol, so nothing to worry about there. You know, about the same, I guess, as a Budweiser or Bud Light. Just not a whole lot of flavor to work with here, though. Try it one more time. Yeah, it's just, you know, it's a bit on the thin side. I mean, the texture is nice and thick, but the taste is rather thin. And so I'm going to go maybe 2 out of 5 drinking horns on this. You know, I would prefer this to a Miller or Budweiser, but there's definitely much better pale ales out there. Also, I'm not sure, you know, they also have a bottled form, but I was just kind of curious. I want to see what the can, and you know, what kind of difference that would make. But apparently you do taste a little bit of the can with this, so that's another negative. So I think it's 2 out of 5 is about the right score for this. However, if I do try the bottled form, I'll let you know if there's any significant difference there. Anyway, let's wrap this up with a quotation. And I found one from Herman Melville, of course the author of Moby Dick, so I thought that was a nice coincidence considering the Ishmael, or Imashel from the Divinity game. Anyway, I've taken a little bit of liberty with this quote. I've actually improved it quite a bit, I think, but I'll let you be the judge of that. So here goes. There is a touch of dignity, even in brutes, and a special halo about a rat that should forever exempt him from indignities. See you guys next week.
What happened up there?
You started spouting poetry.
Poetry?
Yeah. I love you, Sorcia. I worship you, Sorcia. You almost got us killed!